Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Grant Thornton's latest operational taxes webinar. I'm Martin Killer, tax partner in our financial services team, and it's a pleasure to welcome you today to today's recording briefing on latest operational tax matters impacting financial services businesses. I'm joined today by my colleague, Jasmine Chan, director in our team, and today we'll be going through a number of topical issues. Just in terms of initial housekeeping steps, today's webinar is being recorded, and together with the recording and slides, we'll aim to distribute those to all attendees and those registered later in the next day or so. So look out for those coming through. There is a facility, obviously, to ask questions through the webinar itself, and on the panel, hopefully you can see on your screens under the chat function, you're able to drop questions in there, and our plan will be to respond to all those questions towards the end of today's webinar. But for any particular questions you don't get to, or for anything you want to ask on a one-to-one basis, obviously feel free to message Jasmine or me directly, and we can follow up with you separately. And I do appreciate it's the end of November. Crikey, where is 2023 gone, you may ask, but appreciate everyone's busy time building up to Christmas and the end of the year. So again, with that in mind, and with obviously the topical issues we're focusing on today, want to make sure we move at pace, but equally focus on sort of the key issues you need to be thinking about, either potentially this side of Christmas or definitely thinking about into Q1 of next year, as some of these changes we're talking about and some of the decisions that businesses will need to make around these regimes will have an impact on the business and therefore need to be addressed very much in the short term. So we'll very much focus on those immediate steps people need to take. So in terms of the agenda for this morning's webinar, there are three key areas Jasmine and I would like to cover. First of all, Jasmine's going to speak about the latest ISA changes, those that were announced in the autumn statement last week by the Chancellor, and a bit of headway around where things may be heading with some of those changes he announced then, or announced in the budget papers that came out subsequently, but also an update on the ongoing HMRC audits of ISA managers. We've had a lot of experience looking at that with a number of different clients. We want to share some of our sort of thoughts around a pattern, shall we say, dare I say, of HMRC activity, but also for those that may not have had or had the pleasure of experiencing an HMRC audit recently, some thoughts around how you can be best prepared for those audits if they do impact you in the future. And then we're moving on, I'll then cover off another information reporting update in terms of some current themes around the new evolving regimes in CARF, CRS 2.0, and also importantly for those on the call who are qualified intermediaries, some thoughts around the impending QI certification for most QIs that are in the standard three-year certification period ending 31 December 23. Thoughts around the period that you choose for peer review, and also other thoughts around the wider certification process. And then finally, I'll touch on some developments on the EU FATCA regime. People on our last call earlier in the year, we were joined by one of our German colleagues who talked a lot about the recent German withholding tax changes, some of which have been introduced already, and others which are coming down the line, but also the interaction between that and the FATCA directive. And since June, we've had more detail from the EU around how that directive will logically look. But obviously, we do know there's a consultation period, and a lot of discussion within EU circles around how some of the provisions in the directive may be introduced. So we'll touch on that, as well as some other timely withholding tax issues relevant coming up to year end. So that's our agenda today. Look forward to your participation through questions, and obviously let us know if you've got any other comments as we go through the session. I'll now hand over to Jasmine, who's going to talk about ISAs. Thank you.
Thanks, Martin. So for the ISA managers on the call, the autumn statement last week provided a few expected changes. There was a couple of rumours going around, so there were a few expected changes that did come in, but also some unexpected ones. So the changes broadly are all covered on this slide, and I'll pick a couple of them to talk about some of the more topical ones, some of which are, like I said, rumoured and other ones that were a bit more unexpected. And between now and the next tax year, which is 6th of April 2024, HMRC should be releasing additional information, because this is when these proposed changes should be coming in. So we should hear more from HMRC over the course of the next 6 months broadly regarding how these should be put in place. But as a general point, these ISAs are focused on, you know, modernising the ISA process to fit, you know, today's environment where investments are more accessible to different individuals through, let's say, fintech type entities or trading platforms that have emerged over the last few years with app interfaces. And that really allows, you know, investors to have more flexibility regarding where they invest their money. And so in a way, the ISA landscape has already changed gradually over the last 5 to 10 years. And you know, some of these kind of ISA changes from the autumn statement do reflect that. And HMRC have announced plans to digitise their ISA reporting system. And at the moment, there's no further information regarding what that actually means in practice. So does that mean it's making tax digital with, say, more regular reporting, real-time reporting, more specific schema or schema checks? That is all quite uncertain at the moment. And HMRC should be releasing additional information between now and 6th of April. So we all wait with bated breath for what exactly that might mean for the ISA managers and the level of changes that might be needed to the reporting process to make sure that they're ready for this new reporting or digitization process. One of the key changes that I wanted to talk about though, in terms of simplification and again, allowing, you know, investors to have more flexibility regarding where they put their money in an ISA, is the change regarding allowing investors to subscribe to more than one ISA of each type. So this is a rule that's been very long standing. Before, you could only invest in one type of ISA each tax year, and therefore it really limited an investor's ability to, you know, really diversify their income or you know, try different types of platforms or ISA managers if they desire to do so. So this is quite a welcome change from an investor's perspective, that and they can then subscribe to, let's say, two cash ISAs in a tax year going forward from next tax year onwards. In practice, what that means for the ISA managers on the call, though, is first of all, that would mean that, you know, the terms and conditions would need changing. The disclaimers that are on your ISA application, which currently reference this existing rule, would need to be changed. And any other documents that reference that, those old changes would need to be amended as well to reflect that. But in practice, the monitoring of the subscriptions would broadly remain the same. On the basis that most ISA managers only have one cash ISA type, for example, you would still just be monitoring the 20K allowance hasn't been breached. So from that perspective, there's not that much change that needs to happen from an operational perspective, but the documentation needs to reference the right rules come next tax year. Linked to this change as well, and with the additional flexibility, is investors will also be able to make partial transfers into ISAs. And again, this provides them with more flexibility, like I mentioned. And from the ISA manager's perspective, they would then need to make sure that their transfer forms take into account of these changes. And from a you know, operational perspective, you're able to monitor the amount that's gone in, and you have that agreement with the transferred in or out ISA manager, depending on whether an ISA transfer in or out. So that you need to make sure that those processes are updated to reflect this new change as well. What we would also potentially expect is with both of these two changes that I've just referenced, is HMRC would update their guidance at 1.2, reference that. And at the moment, their guidance does typically provide example application forms or example transferring forms and what they would expect, which is not the required format, but gives ISA managers a guidance regarding what HMRC would expect. Those in theory would be updated to reflect this change as well. And another key change that's coming from the autumn statement is the requirement to reapply for an existing ISA annually. That's been removed. So that essentially removes the risk of gap years, which is where if you've got a continuous application and you've got a gap in the subscription, under the current gap year rules, you would need to make sure that your investor is essentially re-documented before you can take on any new subscriptions. And from HMRC's perspective, that's to make sure that that investor continues to be eligible for that ISA. And this is, you know, very, very welcome news, I would expect, for most ISA managers, because in my experience, this is an area that they tend to struggle to monitor and manage, that type of risk. And it's also an area that HMRC, as a result, tend to focus on when they do their ISA audits, because it's something that typically is missed, even though they might have controls, because it's not automated. And therefore, there's definitely elements of human error that can come into play here. What is currently unclear, though, is whether there are any requirements for ISA managers, you know, to monitor this? Are they required to monitor for a change in circumstance, or do they need some sort of separate attestation from the investor confirming no change? And again, this is hopefully something that HMRC will be clarifying between now and 6th of April next year. But what I would say, all in all, that's very welcome news, because essentially it puts the obligation on, back on the investor to confirm to the ISA manager that they're meeting the eligibility requirements to open an ISA in the first place, as opposed to the ISA manager having to check, is it a gap year, make sure they're redocumented. So the onus is falling back on the investor, which I think would be welcome news for most ISA managers on the call today. Another key thing that was rumoured up in the lead up to the autumn statement and has actually come in or proposed to come in is the change in allowing fractional shares to be considered a permitted investment for ISAs. This has been widely challenged. Some people will know, some ISA managers, and it has been in the press as well, where it's been widely challenged with some ISA managers that currently allow fractional shares to be considered a permitted investment, that there's been some ongoing challenges with HMRC regarding that. And in some instances, we're aware that there's been some sizable penalties in association with those differences in opinion between ISA managers and HMRC. So again, this is welcome news. This is linked to the gap year point that I mentioned. This is very welcome news, and again, means that investors could potentially invest in fractional shares within an ISA wrapper, so increasing the flexibility for them, because under the current rules, it's only if they have a whole share and not any fractionals that are permitted investments per HMRC's thoughts. And the basis behind, you know, having fractional shares is so then US stocks that, for example, are really high, or other stocks that are really, really expensive on a price per share level, investors can invest in those. So again, it increases the flexibility for investors. So that is, I would say, a general point and theme that we are seeing across a lot of the autumn statement changes. One thing that's worth highlighting, though, is HMRC did say in their release, autumn statement release, that it's only certain fractional shares that will be permitted investments and that they will be engaging with the finance industry. So at the moment, it's currently unclear the extent of the changes and whether or not it's only going to be limited fractional shares or fractional shares that meet a certain, you know, requirements. So again, that's something that hopefully will be clarified between now and April by HMRC. And other proposed changes that I'll just quickly touch on is expanding the investment opportunities in investment in industry finance ISAs to include long-term asset funds and open-ended property funds with extended notice periods. And then the other thing that has occurred through the autumn statement is that the subscription levels are frozen. So they continue to be 20K each year with the relevant split for like JISAs, et cetera. They're unchanged as well. So if I move on to the next slide, which talks about ISA audits. So if you're an ISA manager, you'll most likely be aware that HMRC have been really, really busy over the course of 2022 and also this year doing ISA audits. You've either received an audit or you might have one hit your desk quite soon, because we know that they are still ongoing. So what I would say is if you haven't received an audit yet, it's likely that this could happen, you know, within the next few months. Because what we are also seeing is that HMRC are not targeting specific ISA types. It's not like they're focusing on stocks and shares or cash ISAs. It's the full range, and it's not necessarily to do with the age or the size of the ISA book as well. We've seen small ISA managers being selected as well as, you know, large retail banks that have significant ISA books as well. So if you haven't received one, I think it's fair to assume that you might get one within the short to medium term. If you haven't had one, what I would say is you can expect to receive a document, which is almost like 10 standard questions regarding your specific processes and controls regarding the account opening process. How do you monitor for a change in circumstance? What are the controls that you have around your gap years and regarding, you know, deceased and closed accounts? And how does that feed into, you know, your reporting process? What HMRC typically then do is they would also look at your last ISACOM return and query any anomalies or, you know, differences or unusual data. And that will then add to the 10 or so standard questions So that might be things like if they can see non-UK addresses on your last return, missing NINOs, that might then trigger some additional questions. So the final list will depend on, you know, the quality of your existing ISOCOM return and how good that is from HMRC's perspective. One thing to note is if you haven't received a audit as well, is that HMRC do give quite short timeframes for ISA managers to collate the data, and they do ask for the sample that they've selected, all of the application forms. And depending on, you know, the age of some of the ISA book, that can be things that were accounts that have opened, you know, 10 or so years ago. So just bear that in mind if you do get an audit hit your desk, because you do need to make sure that those documents are readily available should HMRC conduct an audit. And we have seen in some instances that HMRC have not allowed extensions to these dates. So sometimes you need to pull everything together within the course of a month or so. In terms of common pitfalls with ISA audits, we found, you know, generally that ISA managers have a weakness in controls regarding gap years. That was what I touched upon on the last slide as well. And also, in particular, where you've got that gap year, unless it's digitized or there's something in the system, it very much relies on people's knowledge of the gap year rules and being able to manually stop those subscriptions coming in if a gap year occurs. And that's why it's very prone to human error in our experience, unless you've got a very savvy system that incorporates the gap year rules within there. And that's why we've also seen HMRC really pick on this as part of their audit, and in some instances levy quite heavy penalties for gap years, and making sure that the ISA manager puts in place controls to monitor these going forwards. Now, like I mentioned on the autumn statement changes, these might go away. So if that is the case and you were thinking of introducing or enhancing controls, it might be worth just waiting for HMRC to release any additional guidance before you go ahead with that. Another common pitfall we see is regarding the terms and conditions. The regulations and HMRC guidance are very specific with regards to what needs to be within an ISA account's terms and conditions, and where specific clauses are not present or the language is not quite to the T of what HMRC are expecting. That's again where they take the view that accounts are not valid and therefore they need to be remediated and penalties are charged in those instances. And in terms of penalties, what we're typically seeing is, depending on the severity of the issue, it can range from HMRC applying the £1 administrative penalty and applying it to a per account basis throughout the period of the audit, or alternatively, they might suggest simplified voiding. What we see in our experience, though, is HMRC will have an open dialogue with the ISA manager and agree the penalties and the approach with you. So there is an opportunity to challenge that if you don't agree with how penalties have been levied or calculated. So what I would say is, if you've had an audit, obviously take into account the findings, focus on that going forward along with any potential changes that are proposed from the autumn statement. Otherwise, if you haven't had one yet, have a think about whether or not there should be some sort of internal review done, so then you're ready for that audit, because it is likely that it will hit your desk within the next few months. And, you know, in terms of any changes that are going to come in from the autumn statement, once we have further information from HMRC, we will then, you know, do another webinar or provide further information at that point in time. So that's all I had on ISA. So I'll now pass you on to Martin.
Thank you, Jasmine. Good stuff. So just moving on now to an update on information reporting matters and on QI, as I talked about before. So we just move to the next slide. So anyone's on the previous webinar we ran, I think in the summertime, would have seen something not similar to this. I'm not planning on talking about all of the boxes here. Certainly, I made the point before that there's a lot going on, should we say, in the operational tax space, particularly around information reporting, probably more than that has been over the course of the last probably 5 years, since CRS landed in 2014. We've now seen a series of either new regimes be introduced or about to be introduced, and so therefore keeping everyone busy, and if anything, keep bringing more and more kinds of institutions within the net of information reporting, which includes the goal of the various tax authorities to try and gain more data to understand behaviour of, you know, cross-border transactions or activity, particularly in the new new financial world we sit in. So that's definitely triggering a large-scale change in some of the regimes we already had to deal with. So I'll talk about CARF, the crypto asset reporting framework, and CRS 2.0 in a moment together, because those regimes are very much in lockstep in terms of the timeline for implementation, but also in terms of the kind of approach we expect most people to take to implementing them. I'll also touch a bit on FATCA CRS audits, a bit similar to the thoughts Jasmine provided a moment ago about ISAs. Certainly, we are seeing a lot more audit activity, largely outside the UK, but what I'm hearing from HMRC and from clients and other bodies in the UK is we're not far away from seeing more audits coming down the track in the UK, particularly around this. So that's what we'll focus on. But just not to forget, there are, notwithstanding we sit technically outside the EU now, there are a number of European-based directives which have, to a lesser extent, perhaps some impact for some clients where they have activities on the continent, or where they just need to be aware of those changes because of reactions from or requests for information from maybe from counterparties or from other stakeholders to understand what the business is doing with respect to them. So DAC 8 is the European directive equivalent of CARF. So we expect there's broadly common approach between DAC 8 generally. But the timelines like logically will be aligned. There would need to be a bit catch up going on from some of the more recent OECD announcements. MDR, mandatory disclosure rules, obviously we have them now in the UK. We have final UK regulations in place since the end of March this year. Obviously very much focused around the two hallmarks around CRS avoidance arrangements and opaque offshore structures. Not going to talk about it in detail today, but anyone wants to put any questions on the implementation of MDR in the UK, I'm happy to deal with any questions, but certainly the impacts from our clients so far has been very limited. As with anything, with all of these regimes, to the extent to which they technically apply in the UK, the main thing is you've addressed the requirement to consider them and documented a position as to why they may or may not apply. And as a result, any reasonable procedures that follow from that are justified based on that assessment of why the rules may or may not impact your business in a particular way. So MDR is certainly one of those regimes where I wouldn't expect any significant impact from many clients, but you do need to document your position quite clearly. DAC 6, obviously, no more in the UK, but across Europe, clearly the full gamut of all the hallmarks are very much in force, have been for a period of time. More guidance is evolving from various continental European tax jurisdictions, but my understanding, speaking to colleagues in Ireland, Netherlands, Germany, is there is a significant amount of reporting going on there. Tax authorities are starting to react to the amount of data they're receiving. But again, early days in terms of thinking about audits or reviews of compliance from an external perspective, there clearly is a lot of focus from businesses around getting that reporting correct, bearing in mind tax authorities now are expecting people to be compliant with these rules. And the final one sits on the end there, CSOP, the European Directive Anti-VAT Avoidance, Anti-VAT Evasion, sorry, Directive, which is to be implemented from 1 January 2024. Again, very much focused around payments and cross-border payments by payment institutions, including banks, either between different EU countries or between EU and non-EU countries. Talked about in more detail in the last call, but very much the implementation date hasn't moved. We have seen, again, sporadic implementation by various European tax authorities. I know some haven't even passed the legislation yet to allow for a 1 Jan implementation date, but we're not expecting any change, certainly not from the EU perspective. So like logically, the rules will come into force. And the first returns are due by 30th of April this year in respect to those data. Again, I have to take questions on that offline, but we'll focus on the top three boxes now in the next few slides. Thank you. So first of all, CARF and CRS 2.0. So since we last touched on this, we've now had a number of announcements, a number of publications from the OECD of what the final rules will look like for both crypto asset reporting framework and the changes to the common reporting standard. And very recently, within the last month, we had a joint statement released by a number of jurisdictions, principally those that are already signed up to or already part of the CRS adopters or early adopters, agreeing to commit to introduce CARF and CRS 2.0 changes. Now, very interestingly, the US are also a signatory to that joint declaration. So whilst I sit here with a potential crystal ball of what that may or may not mean, I think it does certainly raise a question around whether the US will potentially look to implement CARF on a broader basis within the US rules, clearly from a cross-border perspective. and logically then whether that would then extend across into potentially CRS. So you know, anyone who's listened to webinars of me speaking for a number of years will have had that question before, and whether we ever foresee the US introducing a broader CRS type regime, moving away from the FATCA regime they've got currently, and clearly the very limited reporting that happens from the US going outbound into different jurisdictions. But certainly based on the statements made in this joint declaration, there's definitely a point position there where there could be some changes from the US perspective going forward. And we obviously know the US have already introduced crypto-specific information reporting regulations, which effectively will take effect already, bulk of them sort of coming through into the reporting will start into next year. And certainly the US have now sort of moved forward with that. So it'll be interesting how that development links in with their public statements around supporting CARF and CRS changes. But in terms of the timeline, so working backwards, based on the joint statement and the information provided by the OECD, we are envisaging a 1 January 2026 start date for both CARF and CRS 2.0 changes, as we like to call them, which would mean the first reporting under CARF and the change to CRS will happen during the first part of calendar year 2027 in relation to 2026. So as you can see, getting to the end now, 23, we've got a relatively short timeframe, just over 2 years now, to when those changes will be introduced. So starting what we're expecting to hear from HMRC and other tax authorities, now we've got the joint declaration and an understanding that people are moving forward with CARF and CRS 2.0, is we are expecting consultation from HMRC probably in the early part of next year, which will cover the implementation of the implementation of UK regulations to deal with CARF and CRS changes. Logically, HMRC will then obviously take soundings from industry, from institutions, and from advisors around how those consultations, how the rules are envisaged to work from a UK perspective. Hopefully, during the latter part of next year, or maybe earlier than that, we might see draft regulations released by the UK encompassing both CARF and CRS 2.0. So what does that mean from a general business implementation perspective? I think, you know, now we have fairly detailed rules from the OECD, particularly around CARF and knowing what CRS changes are. I think we fall into two buckets here. We've got those institutions which are already dealing with CRS, their existing institutions under the existing regimes, and they may have a book of business dealing with crypto, or they may have, you know, type of businesses or transactions which are caught by CARF. They've got to obviously assess the impact of these changes on their business. And they've obviously got to think about whether they can run two parallel reporting systems going forwards in terms of, firstly, changes to their existing CRS process to accommodate the requirements of CRS 2.0, which again, I won't labour now, but we think about some of the changes they've put into the OECD document. It's things like being able to distinguish between new and pre-existing accounts. It's determining joint accounts and you know, the identification of all joint account holders, and also identification of controlling persons where you've got passive NFE customers. So there's a whole gamut of things around that which may or may not literally sit within some of the existing systems that existing financial institutions have. But clearly the impetus now is to make sure you've either got, you can find that information within your existing systems, or alternatively you're designing a process which enables you to capture it going forwards, and especially from that 1 January 2026 start date. That's the first bucket of institutions. They've got a lot of work to do around this. The second lot, which may be a slightly smaller subset, is one perhaps is slightly more terrifying for the unknown, is those institutions who have never been caught by CRS previously, either because they weren't around when CRS came about, or they're just going to be caught by the changes resulting from CARF. They've got clearly a lot more work to do around actually ascertaining the kind of products and transactions that are in the scope of this reporting regime, and designing processes from scratch to identify relevant customers, to be able to classify them and report them in accordance with the rules, again, in line with the 1 January 26 start date. So I would say for those institutions which are more your classic crypto providers or platform providers offering crypto functionality, or maybe even certain fund vehicles which only invest or have been set up to invest in crypto, they're the kind of institutions that have got a fair amount of work to do now to ascertain the impact of CARF, and potentially obviously bringing in CRS 2.0 for any non-crypto related products going forwards. So that's the immediate ask in 24. Hopefully by 25, we will have those draft or final UK regulations implementing these regimes. And I think there at that point, notwithstanding it will be a year before final go live, The focus there will be on building the new systems or tweaking or enhancing existing processes to enable compliance to be delivered by that 1 Jan 26 start date. I think it's fair to say as well, thinking about CRS particular data changes in reporting, notwithstanding some of these, some of the data points now are quite very specific and quite detailed. Probably an expectation from HMRC and other tax authorities, those institutions that have been dealing with this regime for a number of years, that it's not brand new this time around. It's not something that has suddenly been asked of people. I think the expectation from tax authorities, people should have this data either in their system somewhere or the ability to capture it more readily going forwards, and therefore the idea of some kind of softer landing for CRS 2.0 when it goes live, assuming it goes live on Jan 26. Is unlikely to be there compared to what happened first time around in 2016 when the original CRS was brought into law. And I think again the challenge will be around the reporting itself, knowing that the CARF rules, the reporting rules are based around a transaction-based reporting level data set. Obviously information around customers is still the same issue compared to CRS, but knowing that you've got transaction, very specific transaction level data around the type of crypto assets and the type of payments or the types of valuations that go with those crypto assets. The important thing there will be for those institutions which are caught potentially by both rules, it's first of all determining which bucket they fall within, to the extent to which there's some overlap between CARF and CRS. But then thinking of, as I said before, about this maybe enhanced or parallel reporting system, potentially to HMRC, but then on an international basis, where you've got the same issue in other jurisdictions, thinking about how you manage that reporting process going forwards between the two slightly different regimes, knowing that there's a big
and also with the crypto more focused compared to the existing CRS regime.
So again, enhancing the collection points and the ability to capture information on an online basis logically will be key to those preparations. And then finally, we've got go live in 2026. We're not aware of this stage of any delays. Obviously, the OECD are focused on introducing the rules by that date. Obviously, by that stage, there'll be a need for the new onboarding processes to be in place, clearly for new customers post 1 January 26. But equally, the readiness for reporting that starts in the early part of 27 will be front of mind as well by that stage. And I think it's fair to say, we'll talk about audits in a moment, but the level of scrutiny that institutions are under now from HMRC and other tax authorities is not going to get any less, sadly, in the years moving forward. And therefore, the enhancement or the increased scrutiny brought about from tax authorities looking at these reports will be very much front of mind, and therefore building something that looks, the use of automation and technology will be key, but making it as robust as possible early on will be key, where perhaps in the past, when FATCA and CRS were first introduced, there were perhaps some quick fixes to get things over the line in a quick time frame. I suspect going forwards with this, the need to build something with longevity and more sustainability built in will be key. So that's the future for CARF and CRS 2.0. If I just move to the next slide on audits, just a few thoughts here around what we're seeing from our clients and from industry and from talking to HMRC. Still very much a lot of audit activity in a number of jurisdictions outside of the UK, particularly in the offshore islands, the Channel Islands and Isle of Man, Ireland, Germany, Singapore, I could roll a few other countries, but they're the ones certainly where I've seen quite a lot of activity and quite a lot of detailed questions around data contained in returns, and really going into the detail of why things were reported or the way in which things are reported. And clearly tax authorities are using a high level of data analysis to compare different institutions' quality of reports, and therefore one of the challenges around when it comes to audits is trying to justify why you've reported in a certain way or whether certain fields are missing or you've chosen not to report certain customers, which other people have done in the same jurisdiction. There is a lot of activity still around that. HMRC's approach in comparison, having spoken to them fairly recently, is there's not been any significant, any significant audits of institutions so far in the UK. Certainly been a number of questionnaires issued to a number of different institutions, sort of series of 10, 15 questions to understand the approach to compliance, the extent, existence of detailed operating procedures, technical reviews, and perhaps some internal reviews that may have been done with respect to compliance. But that's been the extent of it. But I understand certainly HMRC were always planning or focused on doing audits at some stage. And obviously there was the OECD peer review, which came to the UK in September of this year, where the OECD took feedback, principally took feedback from institutions and industry around how the rules were bedding in and had bedded in the UK, their experiences of dealing with HMRC, and clearly their understanding of how the compliance regime was working. So I suspect, you know, on the back of those meetings, as we always envisage, there will be more audit activity by HMRC in the future. And following on from the previous comments around introducing CARF and CRS 2.0, I would think logically the best time for HMRC to do some of these audits will be in the time between the next 2 year timeframe before the implementation of those new CARF and CRS processes 26. So more to come, I suspect, there. So again, from a business perspective, it's just making sure you're ready for an audit, you've undertaken, you know, some form of review of compliance with respect to FATCA and CRS, whether that's internal, external validation, some form of assurance, looking at data, running some, you know, logic checks around the data that has been reported, whether it's in the UK or elsewhere, to understand whether it would stand up to some level of scrutiny by tax authorities. It's just being ready for when those audit notices or those more involved questions come from tax authorities. So we just move on then to the next slide. We're now going to talk a bit about QI, Qualified Intermediary certifications. This is something that's front of mind for a lot of clients at the moment. So it's under the, obviously you have a new QI agreement that was introduced from the start of 2023. For many QIs, bearing in mind the 3 year certification period sort of runs independently of when these new QI agreements were introduced. For many QIs that were QIs at the start of when FATCA was introduced on 1 July 2014, their latest or current certification period will run for 3 years from 1 January 2021 to 31 December 2023, which means during the course of 2024, they will need to make some form of certification to the IRS, whether that is a full-blown certification with a periodic review requirement or an application for a waiver with a limited form of certification needed, for which the deadline is then 30th June 2024. So what is interesting, obviously, is because we've had the certification period overlap with the change of the QI agreement from the start of this year, obviously the IRS and the latest QI agreement have introduced a number of changes which will clearly impact on those certifications which are due to be made in 2024. So, and again, I won't go through all the changes in detail, but obviously a number of changes introduced in that in the 2023 QI agreement. For example, a requirement to do detailed reconciliations of Form 1042S information between what's received from the upstream custodian and what's issued either to the IRS directly or through withholding rate pools. That's now a requirement to be included as part of the certification and to cover all 3 years of the certification period. You're also required, where applicable, to upload the periodic review report, whether that's been done externally or internally. There were some other changes. Obviously, the big change technically was around the implementation of 1446F and 1446A, still with the taxation of US PTP interest on publicly traded partnerships. It's a whole new compliance regime there, which will play out in the reporting season, which is soon to be upon us. But certainly for the current certification period ending 2023, your compliance with respect to those rules will be full part of the certification, regardless of whether or not you choose 2023 as your period of review year. Some clients, obviously all clients I'm aware of anyway, that need to do renewals under the new QI agreement starting 1 Jan have done them. People may have experienced some delays from the IRS in terms of getting their new agreements signed off effectively. And the main reason for that, other than maybe some delays from a resource perspective on the IRS side, is predominantly because the IRS have been using the renewal process to check QI's compliance status with respect to prior years. So if there are any gaps, either in certifications or in gaps in reporting themselves, in terms of gaps in 1042 reporting, the IRS are definitely taking the opportunity to check or reach out to those QIs to check the status of any what they would call delinquent reporting before they allow a renewal to go through. So if you are facing delays, obviously feel free to reach out with questions. But what I would say is they're certainly spending a lot of time going over historical compliance issues to make sure they've been addressed before they allow QI to move forward under the new agreement. And obviously we've got the requirement for Form 1042 filing electronically. That was an optional requirement for the year just gone by. We're expecting for next year that will be likely to be mandatory in a number of cases. So again, having the functionality ready to deal with that reporting will be important as it plays into the certification process, which will happen next year as well. So just move on to the next slide, please. So this slide really just maybe just a reminder for those institutions on the call, which are QIs, is that the 3-year certification period or certification process to be undertaken by the RO obviously covers a number of different areas, only some of which are covered by a peer review, which is undertaken for one particular year within the certification period. So written policies and procedures is something which people, I say, a lot of clients have something in place or put something in place perhaps when they become a QI and they update it periodically when there are technical changes or perhaps changes in personnel in the business which impact on how things are done. But it's something I would always recommend everyone making sure they do exist, they clearly do exist, but making sure they are up to date and they are delivering compliance model, because clearly with all this, as the diagram would suggest, the procedures at the start of the process, if you don't have, I say even reasonably detailed, but reasonably accurate procedures to deliver the basic level of compliance in terms of documenting customers and doing the reporting required, then a lot of other things clearly won't happen as envisaged. So it really is key to ensure those procedures do exist. And the responsible officer has got oversight of them and is making sure they're updated on a periodic basis. Training, again, another area where people will say that they do training, that they do updates, so they ask for additional training to be provided. But again, making sure, particularly in the light of the changes that have come through in 2023, making sure people who are involved in the documentation reporting process are aware of what those changes mean at a practical level in terms of requesting further information from those customers that hold PTPs, for example, in terms of potentially trying to collect US TINs, the reporting process, ensuring that's done properly to avoid any missing reporting with respect to PTP sales. Other things there as well in terms of the changes that have come through in the agreement, just making sure people, colleagues are up to date there. Systems, again, obviously follows from the previous two bits, but again, to the extent to which there are systemic type, automated or systemic type solutions that are used to generate any form of QI compliance, to make sure those systems have been updated to deal with the technical changes that come through, and make sure people are aware of what those systems changes do and how they're being monitored. So all in all, there's still a fair amount for responsible officers to be considering in advance of those certifications. And as I said before, for those applying for waivers for the current period, they've got to be done by the end of June 2024, along with a limited form certification, which does still play into these concepts I'm talking about here. For those QIs that choose 2022, that do want to undertake a formal periodic review and choose 2023, so the final year of the certification period, which they then get an extended 6 months to make the certification to the IRS, so 31 December 2024, all of these things are still clearly very relevant and front of mind, and therefore focusing on what's happened in the other 2 years that aren't covered by the period review directly would be key to ensuring that certification process goes as smoothly as possible at the end of next year. So just move on then to the final slide on QI. So wrapping that together, I think what I would say in terms of giving steer to responsible officers and those people on the call that are engaging with their ROs in terms of the future certification process. Clearly there's a lot of planning involved. I mean, notwithstanding people have been through 2 or maybe 3 cycles of this already with the certification process, clearly with the changes I've talked about in 2023 and the fact there is more scrutiny from the IRS as well in terms of the certification and in terms of the renewal I talked about. Clearly, there's a lot of focus now on making sure when the RO is signing up to certification is clear, they've got the versions they're making as part of that detailed certification process. So there's never a good time to start planning. It will be now in terms of making sure you've got the timeline ready to allow for that process to proceed. Training procedures, as we've touched on already, they are the key things underpinning compliance program. They need to be ensure they exist, they're refreshed, and that relevant people have access to them. I touched on the selection of the periodic review year. Again, under the new agreement, there is this flexibility. You could choose one of those 3 years, 21, 22, or 23. Logically, most people choose the final year because it's the most recent, based on most recent data and maybe an expectation. Compliance is perhaps in a better shape for that year. Obviously, 2023 is the year in which the PTP changes were introduced. But even if you choose 2022, as I said, certification still covers all 3 years. You should be comfortable that you've got PTP processes in place, or at least you've got things in place which prevent PTPs being invested in by customers, or you've got some level of controls which is dealing with the requirements of the changes in the QI agreement. And again, internal reviews, as we talked before about FATCA and CRS, you know, a lot of clients and institutions will undertake periodic reviews internally prior to a formal review being done. Clearly, that's not for the for IRS's benefit, but clearly for the internal benefit, primarily of the RO, to make sure the processes are working appropriately, the documentation is being collected, and that there aren't going to be any, dare I say, nasty surprises when the periodic review takes place during 2024. So again, I encourage those, you know, who haven't had done any form of internal review to look at particular aspects of compliance around documentation, withholding, and reporting to make sure they are in a good position well before the certification deadline looms. So that's everything I want to talk about on QI. So conscious we're a quarter past, I wanted to make sure we were finished in good time. So very quickly, just a quick update on developments on the EU FATCA regime, which I know we talked about previously. I won't labour the background, but certainly the directive, or the draft directive, released in May, June time this year. Certainly the authors of it, you know, very much welcomed in terms of trying to harmonise withholding processes across the EU as much, to a certain degree, and trying to remove barriers clearly to investment, and trying to speed up the reclaim process. That's things that all investors across the EU clearly welcome. And knowing that there are a lot of difficulties in the current process, clearly in terms of uniformity, there is no uniformity across different jurisdictions, different types of processes, whether it's using paper or electronic based forms to process reclaims, the ability to get relief at source versus reclaims very much varies across different jurisdictions. And therefore a need to revolutionise the whole reclaim process, clearly the big drive at the top behind EU FATCA. So in terms of those proposed changes we heard about earlier on, obviously there's a big push there to develop an EU digital tax residency certificate to enable quicker validation of reclaims. The ability to offer either relief at source or quick reclaims, obviously as part of the draft directive. And then this register of certified financial intermediaries, who will be the people who effectively were policing the rules to allow for either relief at source or for reclaims to go ahead. Thinking about here about custodians, the ability for EU certain EU custodians to automatically register, then for that to be opened up to institutions outside of the EU. Again, it's one of the key facets of the directive as drafted. So we just move forward to the next slide and quick update on where we're at currently. So we've had obviously a consultation was running over the summer. Submissions were made by a large number of institutions and industry groups to the EU. Different degrees of response. Both I think it's probably fair to say there was a lot of chat, notwithstanding the positive elements that the directive was trying to achieve. There was a lot of challenge, and perhaps let's say a lot of criticism by certain bodies around how the rules and issues to work, and particularly in the fund industry, there were issues around whether, you know, moving to a quick refund process could upset the existing relief at source provisions which already apply in jurisdictions like France and Germany, for example, which allow for, you know, more straightforward relief to be obtained by UK funds, whether the EU FATCA rules would actually sort of effectively trump that and put back a step. So certainly there was a lot of challenge there. But we've got compromise text that's been has already initially been discussed. So within the EU working parties, and I know it's due to be discussed at the ECOFIN meeting next week under the current Spanish presidency of the EU. The main change that they've tried to amend is Article 12, which is the ability to switch between relief at source and quick reclaims. So the benefit, the perceived benefit of removing Article 12 is that the FATCA direct will only apply then to quick reclaims. So any existing relief at source provisions that certain member states have won't be affected by the introduction of FATCA. But all in all, bear in mind the revised text that's been suggested, and given the feedback and the very lack of agreement across various EU member states, we're not envisaging any final agreement before the end of the year, and we expect discussions to continue into the early part of next year. I think it's fair to say, notwithstanding the FATCA directive was developed with two things in mind, both the uniformity of withholding tax and simplifying processes, but also at the same time managing the concerns that people have around tax fraud and abuse and transactions which have gone before. There's still a reasonable element of doubt in certain jurisdictions around whether or not FATCA will attain the objective of actually minimising that tax abuse and those kinds of transactions. As well as, I say, the reporting requirements, which will obviously be imposed on certified intermediaries going forward if the rules were to come into force. There's still a lot of challenge there. And as well as that, clearly, we know from some of the consultation responses and talking to clients, the use of electronic certificates of residence, whilst broadly welcome within the EU, clearly what benefit that would pose to the likes of UK and US investors coming into the EU is still not resolved. So how they will develop or not develop an equivalent system for those non-EU beneficial owners is still to be decided. The use of the definition of financial arrangements, these restrictive measures which look to deny reclaims or any relief under FATCA, where there are arrangements in place to switch beneficial ownership or to have knock-on transactions, so like a stock loan or a repo, which change the nature of the investment between the beneficial owner and the source country. Again, because of the broad definitions that have been used in the directive, there's a lot of concern around whether this will work, and bearing in mind whether anyone will be able to certify, or whether a certified intermediary will be able to sign up to those particular statements around financial arrangements is still very much an open question. And I think the other point around the focus is on publicly traded bonds or securities in the directive. Question of whether it's applying more widely, whether that will itself opens up to some form of abuse between public and private traded securities. Again, is another outstanding issue which hasn't been resolved yet. So quite a lot of debate still happening within the EU. And we know a number of European countries, for example, Germany, have said they're not convinced that the past will come in, certainly not in the format it's currently envisaged, bearing in mind changes that Germany have already made to their, or are making to their own domestic holding system. So food for thought there around FATCA. So we should move on to the final slide. In terms of other withholding tax issues, I mean, very briefly here, a couple of points on ECJ, so European case law, focus bank type claims, continues to be activity across a number of different jurisdictions. I think highlights for me, 2023, we've seen a significant case in Spain at the Supreme Court level involving a French hedge fund, which effectively, well, was a success. There were some elements of debate within the Supreme Court around how widely the decision could be interpreted. But broadly speaking, decision held that a hedge fund was equivalent or comparable to a Spanish equivalent hedge fund and therefore was entitled to exemption from Spanish withholding tax. Has gone through at the Supreme Court level. So certainly a lot of interest from hedge funds or any form of alternative fund outside the UCITS space, both within the EU and non-EU, looking to make claims in Spain now. So that's definitely an important case. In the Netherlands, there was a case, not at the Supreme Court level, slightly lower down, but involving a UK insurance company with pension business, which was successful. Again, comparability arguments proven, but it will go through several layers of further of the Dutch legal system before it gets to a final answer. But certainly a positive case for life insurance companies there. And ongoing litigation, we know in Germany, still carries on apace with various UCITS funds and US RICs involved in discussions and litigation with the German tax authorities, which we envisage ultimately should be successful, but will take time to get through the process there. And finally, looking forward into 2024, obviously 1 month to go. I would say, I always say to people this time of year, reach out to your custodians, check what changes they're envisaging coming down the track, make sure any documentation requirements to be refreshed have been dealt with appropriately, preferably before the end of the year. Have been some changes to certain UK treaties during the course, or certain UK treaties have been ratified during the course this year, so Luxembourg, Brazil, and one or two others. So again, if you're a UK investor with investments in some of those markets, making sure any new documentation is put in place to reflect any changes to withholding that arise from those treaty changes in 23, make sure those are done appropriately. And otherwise, it's keeping focused on other changes coming down the track. So fast, we're expecting developments during 2024. And we expect other changes we to develop during the course of next year as well. So I rattled off that quickly at the end. But that really was, I think, everything we wanted to cover in terms of withholding taxes and EU FATCA. So just move to questions. I see we've got a couple of questions in the chat box. Shall I pass back to Jasmine? I think one was on the first one, I see on ISAs. So I'll ask Jasmine, can you pick that one up?
Yeah, sure. So the question is for ISAs, what HMRC's approach has been with regard to the penalties. Have they been applying on a per account level or on a per subscription basis? So what I would say is, in our experience, it really does depend on the issue that they've identified and the error, and also the severity of that. We have also seen instances where HMRC have found an error, but they've concluded that it forms a small part of the review that they did as part of the audit, and therefore from their perspective they're comfortable it was a bit of a one-off or human error, and generally the controls were sufficient, and in those instances no penalties were levied. We have seen other instances where it does seem like there's wider control issues, and in that instance, depending on the impact to the investor, that will drive whether or not HMRC will apply the admin penalty, or whether or not they'll do it on another basis and calculate it. Either way, they always set out the basis for what they propose for the penalty regime, and seek the ISA manager's confirmation or comments before proceeding. So that's a formal part of their kind of audit process. We have seen where they've applied the £1 admin penalty is they would apply it to every impacted ISA account that's been open in the years of the audit. So if the audit covers, let's say, two to three tax years, they would ask for the number, they would ask their ISA manager for the number of accounts impacted, and they would apply that £1 penalty to that. But it really does depend on the issue that's been identified.
Thank you. Thanks, Jasmine. The other point I was going to mention, just in the context of the ISA point, actually, was people may remember, ISA managers particularly may remember, HMRC put out a consultation or a request for information, they called it, a year or so ago, around revising the whole ISA regime, around particularly around the penalty regime for managers and stuff. And certainly, we're still waiting, bated breath, to see whether there's what comes back in terms of that. Obviously, nothing particularly apparent in the autumn statement papers around that, particularly outside the changes that Jasmine talked about earlier, but I think something that's been forgotten, and certainly in the current environment where you've got protections for ISA investors, putting the onus on managers to make sure they do react to customer requests and dealing with things appropriately is clearly something that HMRC will continue to focus on, so we'll see more around changes, potential changes to penalty approaches in the future. Thank you. One of the questions around the extent, the overlap between QI certifications and FATCA compliance. So anyone who's involved in the QI regime will know, as part of the RO certification for QI, there is a requirement to confirm your compliance with your FATCA obligations, logically in the UK, of course, can be anywhere depending on QI is located. Obviously, that's a key part of certification. So if you're aware of FATCA failings per se, then that could actually have an impact on your ability to certify or certify unqualified anyway for QI purposes. I think this is another area where probably the IRS, to a certain degree, probably not picked up on this as quickly as we thought they would do, but going forward, particularly in the light of more audit activity around FATCA and then the CRS and the communications between the tax authorities, I could see more of an impact there going forward, where if there is known non-compliance of whatever nature for FATCA, say at HMRC level, that could get communicated through to the QI. So therefore, you've got to think about it clearly in the context of making the certification equally in the bigger picture basis, thinking about whether that will then lead to further questions from the IRS, even post-certification, if they are aware or alert to the fact there are gaps in the institution's FATCA compliance. So it's definitely the two are interlinked. I know when the rules are first, when the QI agreement, I say, was first redrafted in 2014 to deal with FATCA, one thing the IRS slipped in there, or purposely slipped in there, to make sure they have the ability to police FATCA. That's affected by the back door, but I think that's something that we've got to be conscious of, particularly in the current environment where more of this is happening, more information requests come through. Okay, I'm very conscious we're nearly at 10:30, so I just want to say thank you very much for joining us today. Really appreciate your company and your listening to us for the hour. Hope you found it useful. As I said, a copy of the slides and the recording itself will be shared in the next day or two, so please do reach out if you don't receive it. But also, if you've got any other questions, you want to correspond with Jasmine or myself, please reach out to us with the details on the slides. And we look forward to speaking to you again in the new year. But in the meantime, I will wish you safe and pleasant. Great. Thank you.